Our scripture reading will be taken from Revelation 12, verses 9 through 11. And it reads, "And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil, and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. And I hear a loud voice saying in heaven, Now is come salvation, and strength, and the kingdom of our God, and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb, and by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto death. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word.
Amen.
So I mentioned a couple weeks ago that in 2017, I believe, the church went on a mission trip to Dominican Republic and had a wonderful experience there. And, you know, sometimes I've heard my mom say, be careful what you pray for or be careful what you ask for. So the last time we went, you know, we've established relationships. I know several here who went on the trip have kept in touch. And the elder that was in charge of the painting of the church that we went to take care of, I kept in touch with him. And just over the years, just, hi, happy Sabbath, how is the family? Just your normal, basic conversation. And then in July, he texted me and said, you know, you always said that if I ever made it to the U.S. that I could stay at your house. So I was like, yeah, again, not expecting anything. He's like, okay, well, I have an opportunity and I'm coming on Monday. And I was like, whoa. I was like, okay. And not even realizing that one of the other families that came on the trip as well was also in communication with him. And so, you know, thank God he's here. So I'm learning to be more fluent in Spanish, and I'm helping him as best as I can to learn English. He does speak English extremely well. He doesn't think so, but he speaks it extremely well. But he'll be ministering to us today, and he'll be singing in Spanish. And his name is Brother Marino Espinosa. So please welcome him.
Okay, happy Sabbath.
I can't sing in English, I will do in Spanish, so, but the more important, we have to pray for the Lord.
Amen. Creo en la amistad sincera, sin barreras ni se une en medio del dolor. Nuestra amistad triunfante va creciendo más y más, porque une nuestras vidas el perfecto que la une solo él, y si tenemos que partir y alejados hoy estar, nuestra amistad perdurará y crecerá. Cada día más me afecta al amor de mi Jesús. Ya no hay en mí derrota, puedo amar sin excepción, vivir la vida fiel es para siempre, aunque la vida dura es. La amistad nunca se pierde, pues solo une, solo es. Y si tenemos que partir y alejado soy estar, nuestra amistad perdurará y crecerá. Y somos fieles para siempre, aunque la vida dura es. Nuestra amistad nunca se pierde, porque la une solo es. Y si tú tienes que partir y alejados hoy estar, nuestra amistad perdurará y crecerá. Tu amistad perdurará y crecerá.
Many times we go to go far, but the friendly keep. God bless you.
Someone who speaks Spanish better than I do. What was the title of that song?
Friends are friends forever.
Friends are friends forever. I have a head cold, so you have to overlook me. I have a hard time hearing. So if I say amen back to myself, it's because I hear myself twice. Yeah, I have this echo in my head. I tell people there are three things that I don't like on this earth. That's a head cold, a headache, and a sore throat. And I've had all three of them this past weekend and the week before. So praise the Lord, I'm here this morning. I refused to stay home today. I said I'm going to be in the house of the Lord. I just walk around with some hand sanitizing wipes or whatever. So be careful when you come in contact with me. But I pray that heaven will sanitize us all today. Can the church say amen?
Amen.
Let us bow our heads in prayer as we open up God's word. Father in heaven, it is a privilege, Lord, in you we have a friend of friends, Lord, and we're so glad that we have a friend that sticketh closer than a brother, and his name is Jesus. We thank you, Lord. We ask in a special way that you will bless us now as we open up your word. We pray that the word of God will become clear to our hearts today. We ask that you would touch our hearts, cleanse our hearts, and inspire our hearts, Lord, to be more like Jesus. And may we be overcomers in this life. It's my prayer. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
John, writing in the book of Revelation, chapter 12, we find these words of prophecy here. As we look in the book of Revelation, chapter 12, I'm not going to go through the whole chapter, but focus in on these last, these three verses that were just read to you. John was the youngest of the disciples, but he lived longer than the other disciples. That probably makes sense, being that he was the youngest of the disciples. Many commentaries liken the Apostle John's writings to pastoral writings. They call him the pastoral writer, the pastoral epistles. You can hear the pastor's heart coming from John, and John had the privilege of pastoring the New Testament church there in Ephesus. It is believed that John was living with Jesus' mother when he died. He had the privilege to live with Jesus' mother. That's what many commentaries or many biblical writers, expositors believe that of John. But we do know this for sure, that John speaks about overcoming. In fact, there are at least three books of the New Testament where John talks about overcoming. One of those epistles are one of the Gospels, of it, which is John. He writes in the book of John chapter 16 that you can overcome. You can overcome because why? I have overcome the world. A few months back, when my wife and I, we moved into our house, I had purchased some things, and for a long time, my living room was like a miniature Lowe's or a miniature Home Depot. You can imagine with me for them for a moment. And my son and I, we were inside the house there, and he wanted to do some things, and I said, "Well, son, I need some help." I says, "Could you help me?" I literally invited him to help me because I'd like to try to teach him things of the trade, you know, building and things of that nature. And he'll come right along with me with his little self. This particular day, I had some things lying in the living room, and I had gotten them all together. I can't remember if it was a big tote bag or what it was, but it was something heavy. And I invited him. I was like, "Son, I need your help. I really do." Not really did I need his help, but I wanted to teach him a lesson. And so we bent down to grab this big pile of material, some boards and things of that nature. It was really heavy, but it was heavy and not so heavy that I couldn't move it myself. And I bent down and got down with him, and I said, "Son, grab the end, and I'll grab this end." And we picked it up, and we moved it to the side. He said, "Daddy, this is not heavy at all." I said, "Yes, son, it's not heavy at all." I didn't tell him why it wasn't heavy. But what he was experiencing was the load or the material was light because why? Big Daddy had it. And sometimes Daddy, he'll say, "Daddy, you are a strong man." You see, overcoming is like little Luke picking up under this heavy load of material. It's light to him, but it was heavy to me. And I made all the difference. You see, Jesus makes all the difference. Can somebody say amen?
Amen.
John, when he's writing the book of Revelation, he has an overview of the fall of, in fact, not only the fall of Adam and Eve, or the fall of man, but he saw the fall, or the war that broke out in heaven. And he's writing about this war that was found in heaven. The Bible says that Satan and his angels were cast down from heaven, and on earth they set up their headquarters. And so John is writing in prophetic view of what is happening throughout all of ages, all the way from the beginning when sin originated in heaven. And when he writes in the book of Revelation, he sees a class of people, a group of people, if you will. Not high class, middle class, low class. But he sees a group or a class of people, none other than blood-bought Christians. And he writes these words, and they overcame him. Who's him? Satan, the devil, the dragon, the great red dragon, the dragon from the beginning. I call him Slewfoot. And they overcame him, meaning the devil, by the blood of the Lamb. See, John is writing and he sees all that has transpired on the face of the earth. And all of a sudden, he sees a group that has overcome. Can you imagine with me what John must have saw? He saw all the wars. He saw all the things that a fallen world would bring, such as disease, disasters. Oh, my heart was just riveted when I looked at the Bahamas this week. We need to pray for the Bahamas. We need to pray for everyone who is in the eye of the storm, but particularly, and they're expecting the death toll to rise in the Bahamas. And if you have loved ones or friends there in the Bahamas, it is my prayer that they are safe and that they are okay. But as I look at this storm, as I see this storm, and someone news forecast, broadcaster said, "I hope we never see another Dorian." But my brothers and sisters, John tells us about a time when there's going to be a time when there's going to be an earthquake like never before. There's going to be wars and rumors of wars. There's going to be disease. There's going to be pestilence, as Matthew chapter 24 tells us. So what we have seen, we have not seen anything yet, brothers and sisters. But yet, while there's still time, we have the words of John. He writes to us and he says, "And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb." I want to focus on three points that John brings out in this message. My title today is Be an Overcomer. Now, how do you be or how do you become an overcomer? Well, Luke was able to overcome the heaviness of that material by what? Me helping him, right? And it's very simple. We overcome by trusting in Him who has overcome, and that is Jesus. 3 points I want to bring out. Number one, and they overcame Him by what? The blood of the Lamb. My focus on this is they overcame Him because they had been born again. You know, people come to me, Pastor, I want you to do Bible studies with my child, or with my teenager, or with my friend. Doesn't matter if they're young, doesn't matter if they're middle age, it doesn't matter if they're old. It's always in the Seventh-day Adventist Church, Bible study. But let me say this, and I'm going to go on record by saying this. Bible study does not get it. When I found the Lord, October 10th, 1997, I didn't have a Bible in my hands. I didn't have a Bible in my room, but I had crack cocaine. I was high. What do you do with that? Is there a Bible study on how to get over crack cocaine? There's a principle. Yes, in the Word of God. But what helps us overcome, no matter what it is? Doesn't matter if you're faced with drugs this morning. It doesn't matter if you're faced with depression, alcoholism, whatever you are faced with this morning, you overcome by the blood of the Lamb.
Amen.
And by having an experience with Jesus.
Amen.
Yeah, that night, October 10th, 1997, I cried out, Lord, if you are real, and it is true that you died on the cross for me. I love this picture.
Amen.
There's a testimony that I have about this picture. When I first became a Christian, October 1997, someone said, we're going to go out and hand out Bible tracts, gospel tracts. They call them gospel tracts in the Baptist church, the gospel tracts. And I said, wow, I would love to do that. I've never heard people going out on the street passing out gospel tracts. So I'm like, wow, I want to do that. That's a mission field. I was always fascinated with missions. So I was like, you know, I want to do that. Where are we going? We're going to the mall, and we're going to go and stand on the front out there along the breezeway, and we're going to pass out flyers. And I never forget, okay, what are we going to pass out? Not flyers, but tracts. What are we going to pass out? Well, we go to the gospel music store, and inside the gospel music store at the counter, they have a bundle of these that you can get, like little cards. Little business cards, and they have this picture on the front, and on the back it has a simple how to be saved message. Wow, we bought several of them. And so here we head out to the local mall. We're going to pass out these flyers or gospel tracts. See, I got evangelism on my mind. And so we go out there and we pass out these gospel tracts, and this lady, well-to-do lady, walking in belts, she walks up to me, or I step in her way to offer her a tract. She didn't come up to me. I stepped in her way. And I said, would you care for one of these? She says, I'm not interested. And I never forget, for the first time, I felt that electrical shock that went to my heart. I never experienced such. You see, at that time, at 20 years old, I thought everyone would want to receive this. Everyone would want to receive this, but it's not true. Everybody does not want the gospel. Some people are happy. Some people have it well to do. And they have no need of anything. But when I found Jesus, I found Him to be an aid in every situation that I found Him in. If this woman only knew at that time what she was passing by, and so many others that I've met since, if they only knew what I was offering to them, they would understand that whatever problem that they are facing, God is able to help them to overcome. Can somebody say amen?
Amen.
So the first part of being an overcomer is having that born again experience. Let me ask you a question, a personal question. Don't raise your hand. Can you recall the moment that you asked Jesus to come into your life and wash you and cleanse you of your sins?
Amen.
Let me ask you a question. Are you one of the ones that are saying, I don't think I've ever, I don't recall even having that experience? Well, I pray today, before this church service is over today, that you would invite Jesus to come into your heart. But I have experienced this where people come to me and these children have problems. They say, Pastor, my child needs Bible studies. I said, your child doesn't need Bible study. What they need is the blood of Jesus.
Amen.
What they need to understand is what it means to confess their sins and what it means to give their heart to Jesus. More than anything that I try to teach my young people at my church, at the church school, in my Bible studies, and in this church too as well, the emphasis on having a personal relationship with Jesus. Because if we do not have a personal relationship with Jesus, other personal relationships that we have that fumble and fall and cause us to go south, north, east, west, when that happens to us, we would give up. Jesus.
Amen.
Jesus is more than a Bible study. The Bible study is a means to the end, but it's not an end to itself. The end is being born again, washed in the blood of the Lamb. There is power in the blood of Jesus.
Amen.
And I hear so many say, well, I grew up in the church and I understand all these messages. And the reason why I'm in the church is because I grew up in the church, but I can't ever recall being born again. So no wonder they go to church on Sabbath, then go out in the world and live like the world during the week, because they had never had an experience with Jesus. But if you have an experience with Jesus, then everything that happens to you, Jesus will take that blow for you. And you realize, when these things are happening to me, Satan is not trying to hurt me. He's trying to hurt Jesus. And when he hurts me, he hurts Jesus. See, we're just the object of his love. We're just the object of his passion. And when he seeks out to hurt us, he's trying to hurt Jesus. So it begins by acknowledging your sin. My sin caused a man, an innocent man, one who was loving, one who was caring, one who was had all of heaven but emptied himself, made himself of no reputation, and came to a world to die for me. When I see that my sin caused him to die, you know, I have a first cousin who's in prison for 26 years. He's serving his 26th year right now for murder. I was there the night when it happened, where it happened. And after 26 years of visiting him, you know, he lives with the regret that he has innocent blood on his hands. Innocent blood on his hands. Pulling 26 years, life without parole. Went to prison at 19, just turned 19 years old. I was 16 at the time. 19 years old. Life gone down. Had a 9-month-old baby. Went to prison. And he lives with the regret after like 20-some years, I would say about 24 years. It was probably about maybe three years. He talked with me for the first time how he felt when living with taking someone's life. And the misery that he has gone through for 26 years. He's a traditionalist. He doesn't believe in the way natives, the way I believe in Christ, although I'm Native American. So he's a traditionalist. So he doesn't find a solace in coming to Jesus and asking forgiveness for him. He just believes in the great spirit, the great God, the creator. But he will not go to that step where he acknowledged that Jesus is the Son of God and that Jesus is able to give me peace. Jesus is able to take my sins and cast them away. Even murder, he can forgive. He cannot bring himself to that point where he would acknowledge that Jesus is able to take this guilt and cast it away and give him peace. And just living with the fact that he has taken someone's life, it torments him. And I just can't imagine what it's like. But more so, brothers and sisters, I think on the aspect that my sins caused Jesus to die. And when I acknowledge that then it behooves me to turn from my wicked ways and come to him, because I fall in love with a man who died for me when I was the worst sinner. And brothers and sisters, no matter how discouraged I get in life, all I have to do is fall back to that moment when I cried out, "Oh Lord, forgive me and cleanse me of all unrighteousness." Then a joy starts springing up in me and it urges me to keep on going the next mile. You see, when you get in these situations where you're tempted to go back to your old ways, then a study on the Sabbath is not just going to get it. A study on the state of dead is not just going to get it. You need to be washed in the blood of the Lamb.
Amen.
You need to acknowledge that you have sinned and you have fallen and come short of the glory of God. And every time you linger and you dabble in that sin, you're saying to Jesus, "Hang there and die." Oh, that's hard. That is hard. But when we acknowledge him as our Savior, his blood is powerful to cleanse us. And we confess our sins, he forgives us. They overcame him by what? The blood of the Lamb. Whose blood? The blood of the Lamb. Who is this Lamb? Jesus. John said, "Behold, the Lamb of God who taketh away the sins of the world." And then notice John says something else that is included in this chapter, in this verse. And this is the second aspect that I want to bring to you. And they overcame him by the word of their testimony. You know, I hear people sometimes, you know, I love telling my story, but there has never been a time when I've told my testimony that I don't have to go out somewhere and ask God to forgive me all over again. You might not understand that, but there are certain aspects of my testimony that just come back to me and I'm like, "God, I hope I didn't seem proud when I was talking about my life as a drug dealer, because I'm not proud of it at all. In fact, I have nightmares about that. I'm not proud of it at all. There are certain things I wish not even talk about, but if I don't talk about it, I will forget where the Lord brought me. I have to walk away and say, 'Lord, I'm so sorry, Lord, that I ever even did that,' as though he's never forgiven me for it. Many times I've had to do this all over again so I can get my mind right back where it needs to be." Some people say to me, "Well, Pastor, I don't have a testimony where I overcome drugs or I overcome an addiction, alcohol, or an abusive situation. Father, Scottie, I don't know. I've never had an experience. What do I tell people?" Listen, if God woke you up this morning, you have something to tell. If you ate good yesterday and you ate a good breakfast this morning, you have something to tell. If you have love in your heart, you have something to tell. If you enjoy coming to church on the Sabbath and why you come to church on the Sabbath, you have something to tell. Listen, testimony is not a fiery testimony where someone was almost dead and now they're alive, or someone was on drugs and God delivered them from drugs. That's not all in itself a testimony. A testimony is none other than the goodness of God. How good has God been in your life, and what has he done in your life since you have accepted him as your Savior? But if you've never accepted him, then you might not have a testimony. Your testimony is just that I've been living all these many years on God's mercy, having not known him as my Savior. And if I should die right now, I might be a candidate for hellfire. But if you have Jesus in your heart, you're a candidate for heaven. Can somebody say amen?
Amen.
And you have something to tell. All you have to do, brothers and sisters, is tell what God has done in your life.
Amen.
These brothers and sisters overcame because they had a testimony of how God was with them, even in their fiery trials, the church there in Thessalonica, the church there in Ephesus, the church there in Colossae. All these churches were suffering under the persecution, and John saw all of this. But John saw past the early church. He saw even clear down to our time, when we would be struggling in a world that is so chaotic, a world that is so full with temptations. And I can list one temptation after the other that we all face, I face, from a day-to-day basis. And John said that the only way that they overcame him was first by the blood of the Lamb and by their testimony. You don't stop testifying of how God has done and what God has done in your life and how good He has been in your life. The moment that you stop testifying, the devil is happy. And he's setting aside applauding. I got her quiet. I got him quiet. Next thing you know, you lose your joy. Next thing you know, you find yourself distancing yourself away from the church. And next thing you know, you find yourself out there in the world. You see, backsliding or a person walking away from the Lord is not an overnight experience. It is a gradual experience. We must be constantly testifying how good God is and how good He has been and how good He is going to be in our lives. It's a constant thing. A constant proclaiming the goodness of God. That's what a testimony is. People ask me, what is preaching to you? And in the seminary, they give you this, excuse me. In the seminary, they give you this big paragraph of what preaching is. I forgot. At the time, I did get an A on it. I had to memorize it, but I'll be honest with you, I forgot. Don't ask me what it is. I have to go home and get one of my books. I can't even remember. But let me tell you what preaching is to me. Preaching is none other than trying to give out of my heart what God has deposited in my heart.
Amen.
Through the proclamation of the Word of God.
Amen.
What God has allowed me to experience in my heart based on this, that's what I want to give. I want to try to pour it out like a pitcher of water into someone's life. I want to be a depositor of what God has done in my life. That's what preaching is to me. Trying to inject the goodness of God in my life, into someone else's life.
Amen.
They have this long, sophisticated word, definition of what preaching is, but preaching is none other than giving the world what God has given to me. And I did not overcome in my own self. Overcame first and foremost by asking Christ to cleanse me and wash me with His blood. Wash me from head to toe, someone said the other day.
Amen.
Pastor, are you going to be able to be at church Sabbath? I said, by God's grace, I'm coming to communion. And I'm going to be like Peter, Lord, wash me from my head down because I need cleansing from this head cold. But isn't it true that during the week, we allow our minds to go all over the world? We allow our minds to think on things, and be careful lest your mind start wondering at the things that you thought, oh, Lord, where did that come from? Be careful. Instead of thinking, where did it come from, say immediately, away with such thought, Spirit of Prophecy says. Away with such thought. Don't entertain the thought. In other words, don't say, oh, where did that thought come from? Well, that thought will lead to another thought, and that thought will lead to another thought. Next thing you know, you're out there somewhere, where am I at? No, the moment a thought comes to you right then, say, away with such thought.
Amen.
That's not of you, God. And I definitely, it's definitely not in my book. So away with such thought. Overcoming. It's a life, it's a discipline. Every day we overcome by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of our testimony. So 2 points. Number one, say it with me, overcoming by the blood of the Lamb. And number two, overcoming by testimony. You want to be an overcomer. Now the last aspect I want to share with you is found in the last part of the verse. and they loved not their lives even unto death. What John is saying here, rather than giving in to the devil and his deceptions, because the Bible does say just before that he deceived the whole world. What kept these individuals from being deceived or overtaken was because, first, they were born again by the blood of the Lamb. Number two, their testimony. They had the testimony that they pleased God. Because what God did for them, they had a love for Him. And because of their love, based on what God had done for them by sending Jesus and Jesus dying on the cross, they had a love so proportionate to what God had done, it kept them from ever walking away from the plan of salvation. And by the way, by beholding love, or we hear it this way, by love is love awakened. When we see the matchless love of God to the point that God becomes one with us through His Son, and He gives His own life for us so that we might be saved, there's no greater love than that. And when I see that great love, what God has done for my salvation so that I might be with Him, then I don't want anything in this world to take that away. Amen. And so therefore, I turn from it and go to Christ. Always, when I look at sin, I must evaluate, always now, I must evaluate, is this worth giving into and giving up on that? What will a man give in exchange for his soul? What shall a man profit if he gain the whole world and lose his own soul? So every time I come into a situation where I'm tempted to walk away from Jesus, I must evaluate, is it worth giving up for that? For 5 minutes of pleasure, for 2 hours of pleasure, whatever, is it worth it? When I see the matchless love of God, that keeps me falling back into His arms. Lord, help me. Lord, help me. Now, they love not their lives even unto death. You remember when Jesus told the disciples, He said, if any man thinks to follow after me, he must be willing to do what? Deny himself. Take up the cross and follow me. Now that involves a lot. Shortly after I became a Christian, I received a phone call. Back then we didn't have cell phones. Yeah, we just had an old house phone. And someone called me and says, look, with your talent, we can make millions and millions of dollars. Who's this? Well, if you were singing country music, we could make a lot of money. You know what I said? And I hung up the phone. I said, I'm not for sale. Hung up the phone. Sometimes we walk around with for sale signs on our head. We sell ourselves too cheap at the expense of Christ. Not for sale. I will continue to build houses, sing. At that time, I wasn't a minister. I would have never imagined being a pastor. No one ever would have put that title on me. But I was on the quest of going full-time singing the gospel. And the devil knew that. And his phone call says, well, with your talent, you can make a lot of money. First thing, it's not worth it. Jesus saved my soul, and I made a promise to Him, Brother Rick, that I will tell the world about what Jesus had done in my heart. Amen. How can I tell the world out there what Jesus had done in my heart by singing the world that does the music that does not bring glory to His name?
Amen.
I says, no, not Sarah. Click, phone did not ring again. They love not their lives even unto death. Let me tell you what this verse is saying. This verse is literally saying, rather than sin against God, they would rather die. Rather than lose out on their soul salvation, they would rather just fold their arms and die, lest the opportunity come to them and they yield to it and end up losing up their lives, losing out on their lives. So they would rather die than sin against God. Wasn't it Job that says, I would rather he slay me. If he slays me, yet still I will trust him. As I come to a close, years ago, when I first became a Seventh-day Adventist, this old elder, he was about 80, he was in his 80s, old African-American guy, the first church I joined in, he would stand up and make statements like, I'd rather die than sin against God. And he would say that. He would say it over and over. I'd rather die than sin against God. And I'm like, wow, that's a bold statement. Not long after that, he died. But you know, there's a truth to that. There's a truth to that. I buried a young man. I was training him. He was a deacon in training. 43 years old. 3 years prior to that, he had come to a tent meeting that I was preaching. I was doing a series of meetings, and he and his wife and four children, they all accepted the message and ended up being baptized. And occasionally, we would talk on subjects like the mark of the beast, and you know, he had questions about a lot of these things, and he says, Pastor, he says, it's going to be terrible, isn't it, when we have to flee for our lives. And, you know, he would talk about these things. And I said, but you don't have to worry about that. God will take care of you. But there was this I could just see this deep thought in his mind. He never was settled with that. I guess he knew his weakness. And I remember him saying to me, he said, Pastor, before that time comes, I want Jesus to put me asleep. And the next words that came out of his mouth, he says, it touched my heart. And I still recall these words today, though he's dead and gone. He said, I would rather go to sleep in Jesus knowing that I'm safe in his arms and my salvation rather than living on this world and be tempted to buy or sell and walk away from everything that I know to be the truth. I would rather die right now when all is well. I thought that was a little selfish because I'm thinking, you know what? His name was Edwin. I says, Edwin, God may want to use you during that time. He says, Pastor, he says, I want to be asleep. I don't want to give up. I don't want to give in. I want to be asleep. You know, God honored that request. 3 years later, I watched him take his last breath. He had a massive heart attack. 43 years old. And while preaching his funeral one day, I was struggling with the text to share at his funeral. I'm like, how do I deal with this? Because I knew the conversation that he and I had. And Job says, Lord, hide me in thy grave till thy wrath be past. Mm-hmm. Shall a man live again? Yea, all the days of my life. I will wait till my change comes. Hit me like a ton of bricks. And it made all the sense in the world that there are some people that God puts asleep. The fact that we are here today, we ought to lift both hands and say, praise God, you see something in me to keep me living. And that one thing is because I have found you to be my Savior. One. Bought with the blood of Jesus, amen. Cleansed by his blood. Number two, amen. I have a testimony of how you have changed my life. Amen. And number three, Lord, rather than sin against you, I'd rather you put me to sleep. I'd rather die so that I'd be safe in your arms. I stood there on that day as we buried him. I said, Brother, I watched your eyes as they flickered when you heard the state of the dead, the sermon on the state of the dead, and I look forward to the day. Not only that, I baptize you, but I look forward to the day when I see you come up out of that grave and we'll be reunited again. Rest on, rest on, rest on. Listen, you may not have this powerful testimony of how God has saved your life from destruction, a car wreck, or drugs, or whatever, but you do have a testimony of how God has changed your life and has given you a peace that passeth all understanding. If you have accepted Jesus as your Savior, and that is if you have verbally or with your heart confessed your sins to Him and asked Him to come into your life, you have a testimony, and that is, I was once lost, but now I'm found. I was dead, but now I'm made alive. Would you stand with me as we sing together our song number 340, Jesus Saves, Jesus Saves. We can be overcomers because Jesus saves. Song number 340, Jesus Saves. Service, Lord. We pray, dear God, that you will paint those scenes before us, Lord. how you ended up emptying yourself to serve us, Lord. And let it become clear to us, Lord, Revelation says, and they love not their lives even unto death. Help us to follow the example of our Savior. It's our prayer in Jesus' name. And the church say amen.